the greatest backyard wrestling groups ever will collide.
Oh shit! Oh my god!
For the first time.
Two assholes broke into my house, pissed on my rug, and now have challenged us to a street fight. We need some help.
I'm in.
Yes!
We are the greatest backyard wrestling federation in California. One last time, the movie.
Gala, 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 gala!
Some call these men the greatest entertainers on earth. Flying without wings, defying physical limitations. But the risks these men take are great. Bodies have been battered, necks broken, careers ended in an instant. Yes, this is entertainment, but the hazards are real. No matter who you are, whatever you do, please, don't try this at home.
So who is Andy Johnson? Well, let me tell you a little bit about him. Grew up in La Mirada, was born and raised. Mom was the then principal at Henderson Middle School, and then my dad was a teacher over at Hillview, so I knew how to manipulate teachers very soon after that. But past the time, a lot of our families were into the films, and we just made this, you know, past the time, made movies and watched cartoons.
My phone number is 955-3419.
Thank you very much, Helpy Helper Tim.
I joined Boy Scouts when I was younger. Actually, it was the Cub Scouts. That's when I met John. And then later on, because Dick was a little bit younger, then Dick joined in the Boy Scouts.
Boy Scouting, as much as I'd hate to admit, it was a major, major factor in my childhood.
But that's what took a lot of our time was for the weekends, was the Boy Scout trips for the hiking and everything. And so to pass the time of the grueling death marches that we had to go on, is John would start talking about wrestling.
And it was around these little campfires that I was slowly starting to build my army.
On these trips, when John would be talking about wrestling, it would pique off our interest, so we'd want to, of course, know what he was talking about. So when we started watching Raw, pretty much that's when time was also the best time ever, because that was the Attitude Era, when you had Stone Cold Steve Austin, you had pretty much DX going huge, you had the New Age Outlaws, you had Kane, you had just pretty much The Rock, you know, all the guys that just started the Attitude Era and like brought it into like wrestling a whole new light, really.
And that's how I was able to kind of put Andy underneath my spell and convince him that wrestling was awesome and that he should be trying it and watching it.
that's what really started to pique the interest of all the other guys that, you know, had nothing to do but listen to this guy talk.
Before I tell this Boy Scouts, right, I'll put out the disclaimer that we were not dorks. Now, Boy Scouts has a lot of dorks, and this will prove my point. We decided if the dorks wanted to hang out with us, they had to do one of two things. They had to either smash a soda can on their forehead, or they had to let us hit them in the head with a folding chair. One of the two things, and believe it or not, they lined up. And I remember John Marcher bashing his brother Tommy Marcher over the head with a chair, just thinking, God damn, I'm glad I don't have to initiate myself into this fucking retarded group. Pretty much once we hit Boy Scouts, about 96, it was John, Andy, and I, and we were pretty much inseparable.
One of the times I was hanging out at John's house, he actually popped in a tape, and it was a tape of him and his little brothers wrestling and actually doing some stuff. It looked fun because, you know, who doesn't want to beat their little brothers up with cookie sheets and trash cans?
My brothers and I, we would backyard wrestle in my grandma's backyard and in Apple Valley, which was, as you can imagine, there wasn't a girl in sight. So we would we'd have these backyard wrestling matches with literally my brother Tommy and my brother Steven. So it'd be the same three wrestlers wrestling over and over again, but we would videotape it. And eventually I would bring them down and show a tape to Andy and... in hopes of convincing him that this looks like fun.
John asked him, do you want to have a match? And it's like, sure. And that's pretty much what started from there.
As he's standing there in the middle of the backyard, I told him, hey, keep your back to me, and I'll come in and interfere and take care of you.
Like a moron, I listened to him, and I have my back facing him.
Oh, what the trash can!
And I came and just whacked him as hard as I could on the back of the head with a trash can and sealed his fate.
And after that, I wanted to do this for the rest of my life because I need that chance to kibosh him back with that trash can.
Hey, what the trash can?
I think it was Easter, God, I want to say 99. We got a trampoline from our grandparents.
The day that Dick got a trampoline, I think, really what sealed it for everybody. We knew that we were in trouble because now I can really get a hold of these guys, start doing moves and power bombs and DDTs. And Dick literally lived, you know, 5 minutes away. So it was really easy for all of us to gather around, get together, for me to do a, let me teach you this move. It's called a 450 splash.
And we created this game and just snowballed out of nothing in the backyard. We called it Tramp Wars. And we would bounce, and the rule was you had to fall on your back, and then you could come up kicking, you know, pushing, or whatever you had to do to knock the person off the trampoline.
Then, after knocking each other off, we decided, we kind of looked at it and like really realized that we have a ring now, so then we just went from there.
Yeah, we started having these short little shows, and you know, it'd literally be spur of the moment. We would do spur of the moment shows.
So pretty much when it came down to at Dick's house, there was only certain windows of time to where you could get matches in.
You'd get three of us together, we'd wrestle as X-Pac, The Rock, the Mankind, Undertaker, whatever.
I'm gonna throw his retarded ass through that table.
The filler matches were cool. We didn't predetermine a winner. We would work with each other and take wrestling moves and wrestling
moves. Tilt the world!
If you saw the opportunity to knock your opponent off the ring, you would take it. And the opponent hit the floor, that's how you win. You can't stage how to fall off a trampoline, and you can't predict how you were going to fall off a trampoline. But John was giving this back body drop, and when he went to put his foot out to get leverage to flip me over, he missed the trampoline. Needless to say, we both went down, John's face tagged the corner of the concrete patio. But that's what we were going for. We wanted the painful fall. We wanted the painful ending, and the fact that it wasn't scripted and we didn't plan it made it that much better. It was just what was going to happen, and hopefully something cool and horrific happened.
After a couple of those little TV events, we then had the first real event, which was Trampapalooza, which was about a month of planning to where we had a lot of matches planned out to where we actually put music, our own music to matches.
And to plan this out, John was living in Apple Valley and I was living in Lakewood at the time. We were getting in trouble from our parents for talking on the phone too much. So we just resorted to writing letters to each other. As gay as that may sound.
Put storylines together and have these really elaborate matches and, watching all of us basically just put on a good show and put on these good promos and something that we really prided herself on. It took us about a month or so to really get everything together.
I remember getting my whole family involved in the Trampalooza event. I remember my sisters were cameraman. They would come out. They would help us with skits.
This is a hardcore match. They can go wherever they want in the backyard.
So, it was during the hardcore match with Dick and John, which was the triple threat match, which was the main event for the Trampalooza, that originally John was supposed to hit me with the fluorescent light bulb. But as you can clearly see, as John Irish whips me, Dick grabs the fluorescent light bulb out of John's hand and hits me over the back to where it kicks up and slices me and gives me 4 to 6 stitches.
And one thing about B.A.W. is there was never, ever any blood. And it's not because people didn't bleed, it's because the camera either got turned off or it was a shitty angle. Anyways, Andy got hit in the head with the light tube and gave him some stitches. And I remember everyone got grounded and in trouble except for me. But that also ended all of our backyard wrestling shows at Dick's house for the time being.
Ladies and gentlemen, for joining us, that was Trampalooza. Thank you. We'll see you next time on the pay-per-view.
So with the good thing of your parents both being educators, that they both have pretty much set schedules to where you can pretty much shut your watch to. So I knew that at what time my parents would be home, so that gave us a big window, so pretty much we moved the arena from Dick's house on over to my house, and then from there on we just did all the events and the shows in my backyard.
Cool part about there is you can make a mess in Hollywood.
We went from a trampoline to bed mattresses, which in hindsight wasn't a great idea. One, because it was a Johnson mattress. And two, because, I mean, mattresses hurt like hell. You know, you first hit a twin-size mattress, doesn't feel that bad until the springs finally compress. But, I mean, it was a big backyard, and we didn't feel like we can get caught. We didn't feel like we can get in trouble, because wrestling, we were not supposed to be wrestling.
I remember Andy picking me up in Harlem. In that match, I remember not wanting to take it because I remember thinking this is really going to hurt. And I remember him dropping me right on the back of my head.
Oh, pretty big. It's a power bomb. Oh, that one.
Muppet. He had track shoes, I remember, with the spikes on them. And I grabbed the fucking thing and I slammed it against the concrete. And he got pissed, I remember. He's like, "You can't pull him out, you fucking idiot." And chased me around the whole track. That's how I met him. That was my impression.
Justin and Brian, like, they made our group bigger, which was awesome, because once they came into our little federation, B.A.W., it made us one of those two more guys that we can watch and beat up. Justin was a little scrawny kid, so he was easy to throw around, and both of them were willing to take their bumps.
And then from there on out, we had two more jobbers, so...
Well, we started branching away from using other pro wrestlers' names and imitating them. We started creating our own personas.
Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, in Breeder Bob. No! The man who dates his sister. He's got an Apple Valley shirt. He's from Apple Valley.
Come up with, like, in Breeder Bob, which was Brian's, like, Mace, also Mr. Beautiful, or mine, and then also, like, Buddy the Boy Scout, which was pretty easy for Dick because he wasn't Boy Scout, so.
Buddy the Boy Scout, by far, though, probably, Buddy the Boy Scout was... Yeah, I don't want to call it genius because it wasn't. It was just, I respected Dick for having the balls to show up in a Boy Scout uniform.
Scout O, on my honor, I will do my best to do my duty to God and my country, to obey the Scout law, to help other people at all times, to keep myself physically strong, mentally awake, and morally straight. Why are you laughing? Two, get the camera on my...
School time was prime fucker on time, I think, for us. Hold on.
High school for the B.A.W. guys, and we're a bunch of lady killing sons of bitches, which is a lie.
We were out of our fucking minds, dude, in school. I fucked around a lot. I was known to just be the crazy son of a bitch who would unzip his pants, spit his hand, and jerk off in your fucking eye, dude. That's just the shit that we used to do, man. We were fucking crazy in school, crazier even out of school.
We had our own little table in the quad. Kind of by the popular people, so maybe, hopefully, some of the girls might have mistaken us for jocks or something, but for the most part, we just pretty much kept to ourselves, and we had a lot of personalities and a lot of maturity levels within this group. I remember that first year, Justin having no shame and coming to our lunch table and busting out his little finger tech deck skateboard.
Literally, all we did at school was talk about backyard wrestling and our backyard wrestling fed B.A.W. I would sit at lunch and literally with a piece of paper we just write down what the next show was going to be. It consumed our lives. Like, all we did was talk about backyard wrestling in school and make fun of Brian.
So John was doing a lot of the work when it came to the backbone, because he was actually the brainchild behind the whole idea, because he loved the idea of having a chance to beat up his friends every chance he got. So he got to also do all the editing and also all the music, where he was getting really good, to where it made us more excited to do another show, seeing the finished product rather than just being like just the matches themselves. All the other intricate things of like the music videos and like all the things that just made it really feel like you were watching a pay-per-view.
I was the one that was editing all the tapes and basically putting the music together, and for the most part putting the shows together, just trying to think of what would make sense and how things should be run. But everybody really had their own say. It's just I was the one that was nerdy enough to sit at home every Saturday night and Friday night and edit these tapes down. You know, with B.A.W., we loved it so much, but I mean, we were really just performing for the four of us. You know, it wasn't a big deal. It was just we were having fun. We were keeping the tapes.
If you weren't holding the camera, holding your finger on the music button, you're watching, that's all you were doing. So we had no idea how big it was going to get.
Oh shit! Oh my god! Oh my god!
So with all of us younger kids loving the fact that we were doing this backyard show, John didn't want anyone to know at all, because he was of course the elder of the group, and so pretty much he gave Dick the chance to drop this guy named Anthony Heil.
He's a big HBK fan, nothing wrong with HBK. Had his favorite HBK shirt, nothing wrong with that. Needless to say, he was a huge wrestling fan, obviously, and one day in class, I started talking to wrestling about him. I wasn't as comfortable with everybody knowing that I did backyard wrestling, so I simply pawned him off on John Archer.
Damn Dick pawned Anthony Heil on me. And thank God he did, because if it weren't for Anthony Heil, we would not have met Nini or 69 and some of the other guys that basically did SCWF, which was in the same city.
Welcome to Hardcore Halloween! Yeah. We're going to have an exciting event here tonight. Woo. First, the main event! A casket match! The casket from hell!
Really, Anthony Arrogant was a pivotal point for our backyard wrestling careers. Honestly, without him, we would never have met half the guys that we met. And he was a really cool guy.
So then when it came to SCWF, what was different and which was like actually gave more intrigue to us was they actually had people watching their matches that weren't actually wrestlers. So there was that, the added fact, and then us actually walking in the backyard and seeing like they actually put, like we just had either the trampoline or mattresses. They didn't go much farther, but they was at least more than what we did. It was with ring posts and little ropes around. So that actually gave us more of an intrigue of like, wow, they're actually doing a little bit more than us. So we really wanted to be a part of that. So then that led into then me and John wanting to have a match, and then that was the match where we had against Commander Hardcore and Stray Cat.
It was bittersweet. complete because you're trying to prove yourself and you're getting hazed by a couple of these other guys that were in the crowd that thought that their shit didn't stink.
Are you guys familiar with badass wrestling? Oh, but I think that just pissed off Colossus just a little. And now hits him in the back. And again.
Andy and I did this match with Stray Cat, who was wrestling for the first time, and Gary, which was Commando Hardcore, and we ended up doing this really awesome, like 25-minute, which you can't do that anymore, 25-minute match that really made people kind of go like, oh, okay, so I mean, they actually might know what they're doing. So again, bittersweet because we're being hazed, but once we got the ball rolling, our reputation started to grow.
We were just doing it before, just for each other, but when you had a crowd there cheering you on, that just added more, where you just like, it just sent you into more of euphoria, where you just wanted more of it now.
The transfer from our own little federation, B.A.W, to all the other federations was a cool time. We went from wrestling with, you know, our five best friends in a backyard with family members holding the cameras and participating, to meeting up with all kinds of people from all kinds of little federations like our own. In 2000, we did an event for SCWF, California Carnage. It took place at one of the guys' houses, Dave.
Hey! Welcome to California!
I remember things really starting to progress at that event. We had constructed a ring that, I don't know how many man hours it took, but it looked legitimate. I mean, the rings went from trampolines to bed mattresses to all of a sudden, you know, we have posts, we have turnbuckles, we have ropes that, you know, we can stand on. And the events were progressing as well. All of a sudden, everything was becoming a little bit more organized. Everything was starting to flow a little bit better. Lots of people were showing up. I mean, we went from doing our backyard federation, you know, with five guys, six guys, on a good day, maybe nine people there, to all of a sudden, you know, 20, 25, 30, and things just started to take off from there.
So with that wrestling at SCWF, that was pretty much the end of the BAW, because at that time that's when there were so many other wrestlers there. There was people that wanted what they saw and wanted us to wrestle for them.
We wrestled in SCWF, and from SCWF, SCWA saw us and wanted us to wrestle for them. Then we went to CBW because they saw us at SCWA, and then RWF because Andre was running RWF. We were wrestling literally from city to city. All of a sudden, it happened in a matter of minutes, it seems like. We were wrestling in Cyprus, then in Ventura, in Santa Ana. We were just literally bouncing from city to city every single weekend. And not only that, but we were wrestling in backyards where the parents didn't care. So no longer did we have to hide it or wait 3 months to do a show because we knew the parents would be out of town or on vacation. We were wrestling every single weekend now in front of parents that were applauding us.
And I remember always being really nervous up until my match. Probably because of fear of injury and wanting to do well, wanting to top, like you said, we talked about earlier, talking about before.
A group of people that had one common interest and one common love. And like, you started with that, oh, you like wrestling? I like wrestling. And it just built and grew from there.
There's not really too many after school activities that all the outsiders can participate in and actually have a good time. But with backyard wrestling, it's like you get your chance in the spotlight. Maybe a little small mini mag spotlight, but still. You had your chance to shine and had your chance to show who you were and how hardcore you can be.
We started meeting, you know, with meeting all these new guys, and we started to become close with all of them. Mr. Fantastic, who was hilarious and had a great entrance. Trizzy D, Tommy Malice, who was one of the craziest guys I ever met, really a Dr. Jekyll Hyde kind of guy, because he was so sensitive, and you know, I saw him cry, and then 10 minutes later he'd be wrestling and just be a bloody mess and kicking people in the head.
Tommy Malice never really cared. Like, he would land on the back of his neck. He never really had any regard for his own well-being.
Where we thought that we were above everyone else's level, then we come to find out that we're pretty much operating on the lower level of these guys. So that makes us even want to be up to their level, or even like get above their level to match, because they're just like godlike in the backyard, and you just like are amazed like how you thought you were, and then now you're just at the bottom rung again.
It was crazy. It was cool to see that there were so many people that were into the same things we were into. And everybody brought something else to the table and made it really fun to hang out and watch and be a part of.
Because we were being exposed to all these new guys that were a lot crazier than we were, you know, Andy, Dick, and I are kind of forced to look at each other and go, holy crap, I mean, they're going to forget about us pretty damn quick. We better step up our game, and that's exactly what we had to do.
Everybody was pushing the envelope. You went from cookie sheets to chair shots, went from single chair shot matches to multiple chair shot matches. Barbed wire was introduced. Thumbtacks were becoming a more regular thing. People started lighting thumbtacks on fire. People started lighting tables on fire. People were catching on fire.
These guys were doing some crazy things where we weren't even thinking about it. That's what it really made us kind of just like, you know, sit back and really like take note and like just be sitting in awe of like how they just really put their bodies on the line with like the thumbtacks and like the extended light tubes over the head.
I think that's what made us stand out. We weren't just mimicking this violence. We were violent. We weren't just pretending to be violent. We were the real fucking thing.
Crazy things with chairs and tables and light tubes. I mean, seeing Stray Cat get stabbed in the head with a fluorescent light tube and, you know, and me and Andy kind of looking at each other like, holy crap, like, what did we just get ourselves into? Like, this is about to get a lot worse. You know, guys were diving off of roofs. And again, nobody's getting paid.
You definitely felt the need to up the person in front of you. You never wanted to follow an excellent match. And then once the event was done, that was a good time. Then we would all head to the local McDonald's, Taco Bell, whatever poor fast food restaurant was around. And there we'd all be, 30 to 50 strong, bloodied and bandaged up. Must have been a sight.
So within the next 6 months, we went from a group of just 5 wrestlers from the little tiny backyard to a group of 45 wrestlers that had backyards all over the Southern California area. And believe it or not, it was still just the beginning.
And here comes Mr. Bucket and John Marker! Bucket!
What's the bucket? Bucket. Oh! The bucket! The one who Andy used to accompany to the ring.
I don't know how he thought of it. Well, man, he couldn't have thought of that.
I don't know how the hell you thought of it.
So, everyone wants to know the story about the bucket. And I would love to have this humorous, just great story of how I was just thinking up all night, trying to think of a character. Nothing like that happened. What happened was I was in the back waiting for my music to hit. So I just wanted to spice it up wherever, and there's a bucket sitting right there. And I don't know, it just seemed so natural for a bucket to just to go on the head. And that just wrote history from there on.
Folks, here comes, who is that? Oh, it's Dirt Johnson, folks! One of the members of the Triple Threat! What does he have? A bucket! Oh man, this guy's got mental problems. What member of the Triple Threat is his partner for this tag team event?
The bucket. God, talk about a gimmick that really got him over.
It started as a joke where I started using a little bit more in the B.A.W. Then I started actually keeping it as a staple. And as I was going from different backyard fed to different backyard fed, it was something that was easy for people to recognize. And so by that, then it also gave me more notoriety of like, hey, that's Mr. Bucket. And so that's why I wanted to keep using it, because it gave me that staple of, you know, of recognition of everyone knowing who I was.
Someone put a simple face on a bucket and it became Andy's entourage. He didn't need anybody else.
I started incorporating it in my matches, using it as well, you know, using it for everything. But I never wanted it to be, like, I never talked to the bucket once, not ever. And it wasn't like that kind of like an inanimate object. It was just a thing for me to help. It's just like a weapon that was just funny to use.
bucket, and the gimmick he had was fucking genius.
It was cool watching Andy out there with the bucket because he was definitely the loudest, most animated out of all the backyard wrestlers.
And I would not like to admit, but I will, that I don't know where I would be in my career without that bucket.
As long as I'm the extreme champion, you know, this promotion is getting more violent, because that's the way I do things. Doctor said no more bumps, so I made sure that the bumps today were more intense than ever.
What kind of injuries are you facing right now?
Two ruptured discs, one bulging, recent car accident, tore a lot of muscle in my back, swelling in my spine. But you see, that doesn't matter. I'm the champion. It doesn't matter. The day that I can't wrestle no more, I might as well just put a gun in my head and blow my brains out, because that's what I'm here for.
John was actually getting into a lot more with the Stan or the SCWF, SCWA guys. He was meeting all of these other guys like Andre, and so he was telling me stories about, like, you know, these new guys and how Andre was actually professionally trained.
Andre already had this reputation of being a crazy, hardcore deathmatch style wrestler, a very scary, tough deathmatch wrestler.
The real reason that made Andre stand out more than all the other new guys we were meeting is that he was actually trained by the pro wrestler Supreme, who was an XPW. And that was like, whoa! So to meet someone that has actually been trained by an actual person, the only wrestler that we all knew, was just, you know, like, gave him notoriety, like, right then and there.
I remember first seeing them on the news, and I was like, damn, man, there's other guys out there that are actually as big as us. And the news footage that I saw was disgusting. You know, they talked about closing these parks down and shutting these guys down, the police wanting to run them out of the parks because these guys were so violent.
I remember saying, like, these guys are crazy. You look at them. These guys are crazy. They're killing each other.
Here in Anaheim, California, you suicide. We'll take extreme bumps. You will do anything it takes to be the next SCWA world champion.
Everyone just completely idolized this guy. He had a different type of charisma about him.
And really, the first time I met him, I didn't even know. I just knew the name. Didn't really have the face to a name. And I remember it's me and Commander Hardcore. We're going through the Hardcore Championship. And we're using tables. I remember him yelling at him, you're killing the table spot. You're killing the table spot. This is not even believable.
You're destroying it. You're destroying it. It's like bad psychology. You're losing your crowd.
Okay, now Andre is talking to the commando, saying don't do it. On the roof. Oh.
I'm just thinking, like, what the fuck is this guy? I wanted to punch him. I was like, why are you yelling in my match? You're breaking the fourth wall. So then I come to find out that it's Andre, it's you suicide. It's like, okay, he can say that.
He was very good as to the man was committed to what he wanted. The man knew what he wanted. The man got shit done. And he had the balls to get the shit done.
No, I really don't ever know what's going on with Andre. His mind, he's a wrestling genius. And he'll play the role till he dies.
Man, Andre came around and everybody just drank up the Kool-Aid. He made every single person believe that they were going to be a big, big star.
Yeah! We are the new generation of professional wrestling. More violent than the last, more real than the last. We are the most badass motherfuckers! Yeah! Yeah! We present this form of entertainment. So how many people want to see a show? Yeah!
So then after meeting Andre and after getting pretty much became one of my closest friends, even though I don't think he still knows my real name to this day.
One, two, three. The winners are high class, ladies and gentlemen. Andre, get Andre quickly.
So, I was never really severely injured at all, but there were just two minor injuries. The first one, of course, was that light tube that was in the backyard.
Oh no! Oh!
And then the second one was when I was over in Ventura at the RWF arena, and that's when I was finishing, I was going in to break up the tie-up, and Tommy Malice came in with a spinning leg kick.
I remember Andy getting kicked in the head by Tommy Malice, and the sound of the thump that you can hear on tape when the boot comes and literally smacks him across the, like, right in the temple.
And I, lights went out, like, I remember going, I'm gonna break up!
So amongst all the other things, you know, I saw Stray Cat get a thumbtack stuck in his head sideways, which I didn't even know was humanly possible.
Oh, fuck!
Shit!
Oh, shit,
dude! Hey, fuck!
Stop, don't
dude,
move.
Dude, don't move.
Don't move
him. Oh my god, don't
There's
move him.
There's a thumbtack stuck in backwards in his head.
No.
Yeah, yes, it is. Backwards.
That's a
fucking
thumbtack.
It's in backwards. The bottom went in first.
Andre. Okay, I need someone to bring the doctor.
A lot of guys got the wind knocked out of themselves and minor stuff, but that was a big one.
So if there was anything to say, you know, about serious injury, there is pretty much the serious injury was Richie's knee that had to be the U.E.W. tore the ACL doing the moonsault.
He sat right in front. We had a front row seat for Richie Bowen at his knee.
So going into that match, or going into that day, I should say, he already knew that he's like, if I do this moonsault, it's gonna hurt me. So he already knew going in that he was gonna be hurt.
I remember him getting up on the top and thinking, what the fuck was he doing if his knee was fucked? I remember thinking that. And then I saw his back and I'm like, all right, he's gonna do a moonsault.
I knew what was coming. I knew Richie could moonsault. I knew he could do the moonsault well. When he went up, I just remember a divide. Yeah, between the people where he was supposed to land.
Again? It worked, do it again! Oh. Richie, do it again! Move!
Don't move!
Fucking me!
I fear for these men!
Whoa! Holy shit! Holy shit!
I was not in the area, so it wasn't my fault.
And unfortunately for him, he came down right on his leg from the top of the turnbuckle to the outside of the ring.
And then I remember him going, and as he comes down, he goes out with it. He goes backwards, I go frontwards, and like I don't even get touched. And I remember the ref coming around and he whispers in my ear, "He's hurt." I'm like, "Well, I knew he was good." I mean, for the most part, I wasn't really that surprised because, like I said, he said early on that he knew he was going to hurt himself with this one.
I just remember being pushed out of the way, and pretty much the whole gap split.
And I remember as soon as he landed on the ground, the stupid ref went to every single person to ask how they were doing, except for Ricky.
I didn't know he was hurt as bad as he was until probably like a day later. I didn't think that it was a serious injury. I thought maybe he twisted his knee.
From there, I think they ended up having to drag him back into the back room, and the match continued, but that was really, really scary, and that was probably the most legit injury you can get. He ended up missing months of work, and it cost him a lot of money.
For your main event, this contest is a no-rope barbed wire death match.
So the biggest ruse for injury would have been Andre's ruse of him being seriously injured for the back.
First of all, I know it was an angle, but I bit for it. I really thought that he was hurt.
The biggest hurt. Was Andre when we all fell hook, line, and sinker?
He put a lot of thought into this because he was putting out that like about weeks before that, like how he's been having back problems and like how he would have to retire because he's been having just severe back problems. That man, he's just gonna do one last match and then like, that should be it.
Oh!
And so, of course, it's the last, the finishing move of this match where he takes just, it wasn't even that big of a back bump. I don't know why he went, I think he just played it up perfectly.
I gotta get a picture of him.
Anybody that tells you that they didn't think that he was hurt, legitimately, is lying through their fucking teeth. Because everybody gathered around, he was knocked out. They sprayed water on his face, and when he woke up, he said something like he felt tingling or couldn't feel his legs.
Everybody get away. Everyone get the fuck away. Everybody get the fuck away.
Get back. Everybody back.
You got 5 seconds or else I will smash.
Get some water.
Spino, go get some water. Get everyone to get back.
Hurry up. Get some water.
And it turned us into all of us gathering around. I remember the Ron, Andy, all of us gathering around, putting him on a board and carrying him down to the car. And we finally get him into a car, which when a guy has a broken back, how do you put a guy comfortably into a car? And again, when I say broken back, I mean broken back. Into a car, we get him into the car, he drives away.
Packed it up all quickly, trying to find which hospital is at.
Stray Cat's laying in the back of my truck, Andy's in the front seat, and I think Tommy Mouse is laying in the back seat. Kid Craze is driving Andre to the hospital. You have the Ron and Porno Porter in another car, and all these cars driving, going to two different hospitals trying to find Andre to make sure he's okay.
But there's only two there, and we went to one, he wasn't there, went to the other one, wasn't there. Went back to that one just in case he wasn't admitted yet.
We never find him, so we end up eating bean burritos at Taco Bell to end the night.
But hell of an angle. Best angle ever in backyard wrestling, hands down.
Father, we have to go.
I need water.
Can you feel it? I'm squeezing your toe. Can you feel it?
Right. Don't tell him. Tell him. Squeeze the toe and see if he can feel it.
He can feel it.
Andre, don't move your neck.
Oh, he can feel it.
So, after a lot of the matches, you would hear about these secret meetings at like Del Taco or McDonald's, to where a lot of like the leaders of all a lot of the other different feds were talking about wanting to build and go legitimate.
Andre Verdun got up and started talking about purchasing a ring and taking our backyard wrestling into the independent wrestling. Essentially the next step. He talked about buying a ring and we were going to call it UEW Underground Empire Wrestling, and that we were going to try to make it more legit. It wasn't going to be people spotting out matches and coming together for an event. It was going to, we were going to have practice and we were going to learn how to do things correctly, how to run ropes, how to bump, how to do this, how to do that.
So what UEW did was then take all of the different miscellaneous groups, different feds, and just molded them all into one, and all the titles just got taken, and just all the titles got dropped.
UEW was great because now we were going to be wrestling once a week, but it was going to be the best shows possible.
Andre maxed out 2 credit cards to get an actual ring, and he placed it at Tristan Terry Black's house in Santa Ana. And then from there on, we had every weekend was training, like no matter what. What are we doing? We were there Saturday and there mostly Sunday. But you're there Saturday no matter what. If you weren't there Saturday, then you're pretty much you weren't going to be in the UEW, that's for sure.
Practice was tough. We went from homemade rings that we could make as soft as we wanted to a professional wrestling ring. When we showed up to practice, the first thing we had to do was take 20 back bumps, take 20 face bumps, and then start running the ropes. And it was tough, but you did it because you didn't want to look like the wuss.
Run the ropes for hours, do bumps for hours, get beat up a lot, get chopped, get kidney punched by Triz, all in hopes of really making UEW legitimate. Because, Andre Verdun, he was trained by Supreme, and he was able to, it added some legitimacy to our cause, basically.
Better get your butt down by 10. If you were not dressed, or, ready to go in the ring by 10, you were going to get chopped up and down.
During these trainings that were really rigorous, especially for like 16-year-old kids, I mean, granted we had our stamina, but, for 2 16-year-old kids to be running the ropes, and you're hitting steel cables and you're pissing blood, and I remember Jamie Blaze, who's a tough kid, would roll over and just start throwing up on the side of the ring, and it almost seemed inhumane. But once we started learning how to bump and it started to hurt less, that's when we started getting really excited about these future shows.
So it was at that point that pretty much UEW started and backyard wrestling was left in the days of the old.
kind of a cool thing to see that all these kids from all these different areas with the same passion were able to get together and make a show.
We started having really great mop shows, and so the mop shows were actually getting their name out there. Now with our name getting out there, then brought, you know, press of all these TV shows, all these TV news anchors wanting, you know, because they did Bleeds and Leeds, and we definitely did a lot of bleeding, so they definitely wanted to get a piece of, you know, watching what's going on in their backyards as youth today.
BN News 13 starts right now.
Thursday night in our top story, neighborhood mayhem, backyard bashes. Some teenagers in California working on their moves, and there is no faking going on here.
For the first time, backyard brutality like you've never seen.
At a home in Santa Ana, teenagers staged a shocking afternoon of backyard wrestling, and we caution you, these images are violent.
You know, you have that, you know, uneasy feeling of hopefully you can put on a good show, especially with the cameras there, who wanted to interview me later on, and I gave them the best line that, you know, What is my line?
Any pain anywhere?
No. Pain's a virtue.
Pain is a virtue! I can't believe I forgot that.
They badmouth us and everything, but we are the kids that buy their pay-per-views, buy their t-shirts, buy the $35 cheap seats just to see our superstars, and then they have the nerve to badmouth us just because we want to do what they do.
If U.E.W. wasn't going to make it, I thought for sure that it would give them the exposure that they would need to make a career out of what we were doing. But just like everybody else, I really had high hopes, and I thought that we were on the verge of taking off.
You know, we were renting these huge buildings, and we're driving these places, and people are actually paying to see us wrestle, which is incredibly humbling. But like, man, it really felt like this is gonna work, man. This is really gonna work.
Having these shows now be booked in arenas to where there was not just wrestlers, but many, many, many fans that were just there just to, you know, have a good time, and just to hear them chanting, "Fuck it, fuck it," just made me want it more and more and more, and I just couldn't get enough of it. I just wanted more and more of that feeling of being chanted and cheered and just, you know, pull through.
Yeah, you know, I hate to say it, but Andy Johnson had fans chanting Bucket. This Bucket thing was actually really starting to get over in these big buildings with great acoustics.
Andre first started talking about UEW, I was really inspired. I thought that for sure we were going to be a part of something that was going to be great. And it was. It was a lot of fun. I, just like everybody else there, had hopes that it would, you know, perspire into something that could be on TV or that could leapfrog us into the actual business.
So there was no one that was in UEW that did not believe that it would be the most successful thing out of all their lives. So when it comes to my run, run like a Muppet, because it just seems like it makes people smile when you see a girl with a guy with a bucket on his head run like a Muppet.
Andy Johnson, we had this thing with Andy. We call it he got the nickname the Muppet, because when he would run to the ring, he would have his arms out and he's running around and basically in a circle, and it just looks so animated and so Muppety.
Then of course with that, and then I also throw in the Donald Duck, which really gets the kids going.
I do like the Donald Duck. I'll admit that.
But music, which really was a great progression, because actually this music was actually used as the Triple Threat theme music back in B.A.W. And so when we were coming out of B.A.W., like, John already had his music and Dick already had his music, and really, like, I was still kind of fluctuating, and like, just Magic Carpet Ride was just so much of a fun song that it just fit my character so much that I just kept it, and it just worked. So on so many levels. So as I progressed, I started actually thinking up of my own moves, my own style of moves, and they were patty cake elbow drop.
One, two, three.
I did the no slap sucker.
No slap. No slap. No slap sucker. No slap sucker.
I did the instant karma, which was the electric chair drop. And I did a lot of moves involving the nose, like the nose job.
Nose job!
Nose factor.
Damn it! Nose
factor. So also the move, the good taunt was how do you start a motorcycle? You kick start it, so you have your foot on the opponent's head, and you're just kicking off the head, so it makes the crowd go nuts for you.
How do you start a motorcycle? You're kickstarted! You're kickstarted!
And of course, what I thought of, the bucket bomb. You're gonna edit that out, aren't you?
The bomb.
The bucket bomb!
Oh, good lord, no!
What the hell is a bucket bomb? We're gonna find out right now!
See? There's a bucket bomb! Good night!
Oh.
Backyard Wrestling had acquired a particular group of fans, and some of these guys were kind of artsy-fartsy guys, and they always had their cameras, and to be honest, I thought they were a little bit weird. But they had an art show in Hollywood, and I remember showing up to the art show, not knowing what to expect at all. Through their pictures, the mentality of what we were doing. And I remember the art show taking place and then a mini event taking place inside the art show. It was a unique event because we were in such a confined area, but it was good because it was loud, everybody talked. Really, a good thing that came out of it.
Being 17 at high school and not really being ashamed of what I was doing, I brought my tapes into my classes, all my classes, and get so many props, and like all the guys would just be fucking loving it, and the girls, which is great. Where I had people coming up like, hey, I saw you in the news last night.
So we started getting covered by the media, not actual media, after a while.
Several news outlets actually interviewed us and ran footage of us. And we even had a cover story in the LA Times, and I was horrified when I saw Andy's mug right there when I opened up the paper one Sunday morning. It was horrifying.
Cheering on favorites like 16-year-old Andrew Johnson, the Bucket.
No, Mr. Bucket! No! All right!
It's called backyard wrestling. And unlike the real sport, the action you see is for the most part unrehearsed. These kids claim it's real.
These teenagers say they're wrestling fans who want to be like the stars of the WWF. With music blaring, fans shouted their pleasure at all the violence, taunting, and plot twists.
Cuidadosamente su vecindario. Porque a pesar de la aparente tranquilidad, detrás de las cercas existe otro...
It was cool that we were getting covered by the media. It was cool that, people were noticing what we were doing, for bad or for worse, and...
I was fucking pissed for one reason. One reason only. That son of a bitch, Andy, he stole my quote. And I will not let that fucking go to this day. He stole Arden me nudes, and for the record, I'm gonna look at the camera, for the record, that's my quote.
Wait a minute! Ah, the nudes!
Oh no!
But other than that, dude, I loved it, dude. I love seeing you guys on the fucking news. That shit was awesome.
We were gods among the mortals in that time.
It was a show, I can't remember where exactly it was, but there were a lot of brown-skinned people there, and there may or may not have been a racist Nazi gimmick, and he was calling a lot of people beaters and spicks and stuff, and there may or may not have been some beer bottles and beer cans thrown at him. Yeah, but the... But it was just crazy, funny, humorous racism, I think, that got taken out of content.
There's a couple things that come to mind when we talk about my favorite moment in backyard wrestling. Right away, some of the most insane things I've ever seen would have to be Triz jumping off the roof through a double set. I think he did it to Strika. Another moment with Stray Cat I remember is the Ron jabbing a fluorescent light tube into his forehead. I thought it was disgusting, but absolutely insane.
You know, I tell you time and time again, the Ron is high class. The Ron.
Oh my God!
We're gonna have to rush Stray Cat to the emergency room.
Watching the Stray Cat matches always made me just fear for his life, because that poor kid, he did, I'm pretty sure he used all of his 9 lives.
I got to know Stray Cat first online, where he was a very, very witty, very outspoken individual, hilarious to talk to on the internet, but when you meet him in person, he's a very quiet guy, and when you see him in a match, he's a quiet guy who will get the living crap beat out of him. And
holy shit moments for me was, the first big one was Trizzy D giving the pentagram or crucifix off the top of the E.W. group to Anthony Aragon and damn near killing the kid. And I remember he didn't even know it was going to happen. Triz just picked him up, and that's how Triz worked. He picked him up, ran off the roof, and was like, good, I just made you.
My favorite guys to watch was, of course, I always loved the Trizzy D matches because pretty much he had the factor of getting the crowd worked up, and like that's what I liked. It was like you gotta have that factor of getting the crowd into it. Because if you don't get the crowd into it, then they're not really pulling you through and not helping you out. So he was always great.
I think that's all you have some water.
Who wants some water? Nobody wants any water, man? I'd like to stop by the
So my favorite event is, of course, the first event. And it's not just because it is the first main event for U.E.W., it's just because how it all completely went down was just awe-inspiring. my match versus Trizzy D, they had at least like 60 to 80 people in that little, in that auditorium. And like, this is the first time that we're in a building. We have a crew, we have people that aren't wrestlers watching us, and we also know what we're doing now. And so we just put on one of my best matches ever in my life.
Andy Johnson Triz match at the Memorial Show, what made that match, it had everything going for it. You had a great atmosphere, good crowd, our first show. You had people that cared about Andy and that did not like Triz, because Triz did a good job of just really healing it up, and they wanted to see Andy win.
The craziest thing I saw was when Triz gave Andy the Kryptonite Crunch from the ring apron through a table to the outside on the concrete. First of all, the table looked like it didn't even hold him. It went straight through down to the concrete. And Randy beat him up, and he could take some pretty hard bumps.
Everything involved, everything just went together perfectly.
It went perfectly. We didn't blow any spots. We had the crowd perfectly. It was just, seriously, everything went out without a hitch.
I was sad when U.E.W. ended, because it just ended so quickly. Literally, we were having shows, and then there was this rumor about Andre doing drug deals out of one of the arenas, and it literally ended like that. And of course, this drug deal thing wasn't true. We had this feud with SCWA, and it ended literally that quick, and I remember being so bummed out about it.
Everyone just stopped. It was really weird, I mean, but really, it just came to all of us where I think we lived, eat, breathed it. But then that was before we really got into our adulthood lives, and then once we reached that adulthood, unfortunately, it's just everyone, you know, to say not grow up, but got into different lives to where we just weren't that group anymore.
Looking back at it, it doesn't seem strange that all these people who love wrestling that don't really have anything else going on in their lives just got together and banded together and made just one big family. We all just happened to beat the crap out of each other at the same time.
But the thing with UEW came 10 years too soon. I think if UEW, the same group with the same wrestlers that at the same time would have existed today instead of 10 years ago, with the internet and how things are now, it would have really, I think, taken over. It would have really been something. It's unfortunate, because I really love, the best memories I have are in that Fed.
The fact that I actually got to be involved in it was pretty cool, because I really didn't think I'd just be able to get thrown into it. You know, it's not like an SCWF show. It's not like, you know, an IWL show, you just throw you in because you're a friend, you know? I thought it was pretty cool that I was involved in it like that, too.
Hey, go outside to the fucking ring!
Hey, kick once! Come here!
What the fucking wrestle for me, dude!
Good God! What the hell? I
don't really think UEW necessarily failed. We were young. You know, we were young. We were we knew what we wanted, but we just really weren't sure how to get there. But it did all right for a while. I mean, the Federation was going places, renting out venues, selling tickets, getting some money back.
Pretty much that's when you got introduced to like adulthood, where you had, you know, you had to get jobs, you had to survive, you had to do all these things. So it just, the support it had just kind of fell by the wayside.
I got out of it a little bit earlier than the other guys. I think I started playing football, and then after that I started and I got a job, and between working, that was pretty much my life for a few years.
Finding places to live, I had to drop out of high school because I didn't have a place to live. And that was kind of crazy and rough too. And pretty much just after that, I was just trying to stay alive, man, trying to make an honest buck any way I could. And that's just life, though.
So my life after backyard wrestling, really what took me down was pretty much, you know, found a girlfriend, moved in with her, pretty much stole 6 years of my life.
After the backyard wrestling phase died, most of us started going to work or going back to school, while others, I guess, started a different stage of their lives, so to speak.
You know, unfortunately, as much as I tried to kick him away, Andy Johnson still kind of stuck around after backyard wrestling and was to blame for some me getting involved with drinking beer and meeting my wife. Thanks.
I got caught fucking in a park too once by a bum. That shit was hilarious. And it was because I was homeless. Bum said, caught you with your cock out. I turn around. Fucking guy like just sitting there probably jerking off for all I know, you know, and watching me and my ex go at it.
You know, just like every group of high school guys, we started drinking a little bit. And that's when the good times really started. But I do got a story about myself. Andy Johnson had a house party, and I remember John was on this sobriety kick for a while. And in order to peer pressure John into drinking, I remember telling him at one point early on in the party that I would match him two shots for every one shot of Jose Cuervo. I do remember some of the last like conscious thoughts of memory were me falling in a bush. And I remember throwing up in the middle of the party at Andy Johnson's parents' house, and I saw a cooler. But no, I missed the cooler. Someone slides it in front of me, I puke all over the place, and I get puke on my shirt. Apparently, somebody gives me one of Andy's old shirts, and I change in front of everybody right in the middle of the party. And hours, 20 minutes to an hour later, I end up passing out in the front lawn with my head in the daisies.
So even though the U.E.W. stopped, pretty much there was of course the core people that continued to go with it, like Scorpion Sky Andrews, Andre, Leroy.
What really took me back was when, you know, you turn on MTV and you see the guy who bought the wrestling ring for you and all those credit cards coming out, and you're on TV, you're legit, you know. And I'm not talking, you know, public access. You're talking MTV, yeah. Jealousy and then a sense of I knew that guy, you know, comes through. And and then some of the other guys like Scorpion Sky Andrews, you knew that he was going to find some way to do this for or at least temporarily for a living.
Along with going pro, I know Trizzy D and Leroy started a stunt group called No Mercy Video that some of the guys have been a part of over the years. And I guess you can say No Mercy Videos have become the internet darlings, so to speak, of the Tosh.0 era.
So I still stay in contact with a lot of the guys like Eric Trejo and also like Chaz and also Ryan Rage and whatnot. But for the most part, once UEW ended, that was pretty much the end for me. So it was only a mere 8 years later and a couple of six packs later that John came to me with this idea of doing another show just as kind of like a final hurrah for one last time.
The idea for the movie, sorry, that was my idea. I was just jonesing so bad to have one more show because I knew all of us had it in us. And I remember coming to Andy first, who I knew would want to do it, but then going to to Dick and to a couple others and saying, would you guys be interested in doing a show? And knowing that they wouldn't want to do it. And every single one of them astoundingly said, we have to do another show. We have to do another show.
The movie, if I remember correctly, it was John's brainstorm, and we kind of agreed to do it. And then everybody started getting excited about it. We started thinking about ring options, trampoline options.
The concept of the movie was really simple. Two backyard wrestling federations from the same city were going to wage war and have the ultimate showdown in this ultimate event. And the two teams were going to be B.A.W. and the Wombats.
And so that's what just led us into, you know, having the feud and having us, you know, giving us all the ideas of finding, you know, it's been 8 years, so we gotta go find all of our old wrestlers.
What was that for? Take that!
God, he's never looked better! weed, man?
Oh, I got plenty of weed.
Oh, well, I got DJs in Thailand.
Yeah, sounds good.
Bring him to us.
I got plenty of weed.
Oh, there's weed?
Plenty of weed.
All right.
Oh, for your kind, there's plenty of weeds.
All right. Here it is.
When we started filming the skits, John approached me with this idea that he and Andy would find me and I would be born again dick, so to speak. I would be walking out of a church with a Bible, and I found Jesus, whoever that is, and they were going to try and lure me back into backyard wrestling.
Well, then you've come to the right place. Jesus and I are always here to help you.
Yes, I love a good Hispanic joke too, but right now, Dick, this is not the time. I've got a big problem, and he's got to come along with me.
Yeah.
That's why I'm here for you. I had two guys come into my house, piss on my floor, and not only have the audacity to break a vase, they also challenged us to a street fight, and then the kicker, they're obviously not smart because they thought that we were fat and out of shape.
Best shape ever!
Well, gentlemen, at a time like this, I refer to the good book, and it tells me to forgive and forget.
What's a good book?
I think anything by Stephen King, really.
Stephen King.
That's true.
Angels and Airwaves.
That's a good one.
We did these great skits beforehand to kind of get a plot going, and we naturally, most of us are pretty good at acting and kind of talking on camera.
At first, I was really, really excited. I thought this was going to be fun. You started trying to think of how the old moves you used to do, the names of the moves, the names of your buddy's finishers, and trying to remember how to work a match and what looked good and what didn't look good. John finally got the trampoline, and then I started getting worried. I remember thinking, fuck, what happens if I actually get hurt? You know, now I got a full-time job, and I got to go to work each day.
I was never, ever worried about getting hurt, even in the wrestling room. In the last match all the way to the first matches I used to do, never thought about it, never. It's because I trusted everybody that I wrestled with.
Yeah, we did a few things to train. John got the trampoline before the event, obviously. I remember going over there a few times. It was kind of humbling, though, realizing how out of shape you were.
Before, when I used to do backyard wrestling, a lot of B.A.W, SCWF, U.E.W, whatever, I didn't have to fucking do shit. I was constantly acting in soccer, I was constantly doing sports, track, if not track, I was doing wrestling. I was constantly acting in sports, so I was always in shape throughout those days. So the last show for B.A.W, I had been drinking for 4 years, I had been smoking for 4 years, doing drugs for 4 years, I was not in the shape at all. What I did was I just got back in my old mentality. I started listening to my old death metal. I started, just not giving a flying fuck, dude. Being the crazy ass Jap that I used to be in high school.
So the show was actually filmed at the old arena, the first arena, for which was John's grandma's house. It was in the backyard on the trampoline, and that's where we got pretty much all the old wrestlers, even Fat Bastard. We had Dick, Justin, we got Nick, and then also Andreas and Anthony and Richie, and then we also got a couple of the UEW guys. We had Chaz and Eric Trejo, help out with filling up a couple of the spots too. So
I remember I woke up excited. I actually ate breakfast that day, and I don't eat fucking breakfast.
The morning of the show. Remember, there was a lot going on that day. Seeing everybody here was really cool. The atmosphere was back. It was great. It was just like all the other events, and it's always fun to watch the other people go, and then when it's your turn, you get a little bit nervous, get a little bit stage fright.
I'm the commish, Fat Nick, and this is one last try.
And eventually, after maybe 4 months of, or no, yeah, probably about 4 months of talking about it, we actually got to film it.
Oh shit!
Holy shit! Holy shit!
I remember thinking that I didn't think Andy might have been ready because I didn't know how long it's been since he's wrestled. I didn't think he'd be up for taking a lot of big bumps or taking a lot of big things, but he fucking surprised me. He took a lot of shit.
The hardcore match. The match itself, a lot of work went into spotting it out. I remember going over it time and time again.
That's how good we are right here.
Uh-huh.
Years and years of practicing this shit. Ready?
Huh? Ah! Andy's hip toss off of the trampoline through the table. God, that came out so much better than I expected it.
Mic check! One, two, good!
He took the highest ass bump I've ever seen. That was, honestly, that's probably my favorite part of the entire match.
Originally, when you go off, you go off pretty flat. But these guys flipped me over, which is quite amazing. They flipped me over quite fast, and so I came ass first and pretty much knocked my spine into my eye sockets.
When Dick came running in with the picture frame, I remember Andy was making a big fucking deal about that.
Oh, oh shit! Holy shit!
I wish I knew who told me to do it. I can't take credit for it, but I was running around and someone might even handed it to me. I think it might have been John. I think John handed it to me and said, hit Andy with this. And without thinking, I thought, sure, why not? You know, if I hit Andy with it, I won't get hit with it. So I smashed him good.
Cut. Oh, really?
Oh, you didn't know?
Oh, really?
Your ass better call somebody.
Really?
You knew about the frame, but in the match, I could tell he was going to forget about it, so I may have just gone.
You said hit him with this!
He said hit Andy with this, is what he said. Kind of like when I told Keith.
You son of a bitch!
Andy, son?
What?
No! Oh! God, no!
Richie's entrance was the most homosexual thing I'd ever seen. But that's just Richie's entrance. He comes out with a fucking belly shirt, shaking his gut around. But I swear to God, that is the one gut that is the most hypnotizing thing I will ever see. Ever. I compliment him on his gut because it's so hypnotic. It's fucking like scrumptious, delicious almost, dude.
The tag team match between Andy and John, Richie and Anthony, the thing that stands out most in my mind is this move they did. I'd never actually seen it, and I think it's one of the coolest moves I've ever seen. I would never take it, I would never give it. It was a little bit out of my league, but the Canadian Destroyer, oh my God. Unbelievable move.
I remember them stiffing the shit out of John. A lot. Like, a lot of the moves were hella stiff, and I'm sure he was doing the same to them, too.
I remember getting my ass kicked, and Richie just punching and kicking Andy and I, dropping shit on us, dropping a ladder on us.
I was being the cameraman for it. I was on top of the staircase that we had, which was John's old doughboy staircase that he used to have. We were kind of using it as an entrance ring for it. And I don't know why, I just thought it'd be a good angle to get while Richie, Anthony, and Andy were fighting right there outside. I just thought I'd stand up and get kind of an up top angle over the top head. And I didn't think anything about it. I should have been standing on the trampoline, but I was just standing on the stairs, didn't think anything of it. And I just remember Richie grabbing Andy, or Anthony grabbing Andy, and he just swung him into the damn thing. And I fell straight from the top of the thing, straight down.
Stop!
Destroyed the whole staircase, ruined it. I'm sure John didn't plan on that. He probably wasn't happy. The only positive thing I can say is I didn't destroy the camera. I kept that motherfucker up.
Are you okay, Satan?
Holy shit! Holy shit! When we finished the event, you had a sense of accomplishment. We got it done. We've been talking about it. We planned it for 4 months. And it was all said and done, so we thought. It was cool because all the matches looked really, really good. All the spots that we, all the big spots we planned went well.
We really showed that we still had it. Poor Andy, I mean, like, I give Andy credit. Like, he took a shitload of bumps like he hadn't taken in a long time. He really, like, went all out. He wanted to make it count, and I remember pushing him for that too, saying, please, like, make sure that, like, you really, like, this is something you want to remember. This is something you want to give your kids.
The movie was really a goodbye to our childhood, so to speak.
Backyard wrestling really gave me, like, pretty much the amount of confidence, because, you know, it's not easy getting in the backyard of some stranger's house in front of people that you don't know, and all you're doing it is for them, and also for the fact of your own pride of, you know, you get to go home and watch this and watch it over and over again and have it for the rest of your life. And so really, backyard wrestling really gave me I don't know where I would be without having that such an intricate part in my adult development. So to prove how much of a family that this group was, is that we just had another reunion recently. And just with that reunion, it's already sparking ideas and having a reunion show and maybe even having a reunion tour to where we're going to do a couple shows. So that just goes to show you that even us just meeting together again, the sparks of the flame start up to where we know that we need to do more because we feel that we need to give more. Like we still have a lot more to give. The last 10 years, I've done more things and appreciated more things. I know I'm going to be a part of this because it's just like the mob. You know, you try and get out, you try and get away from it, but you cannot, because it will always be a part of you and you will always get dragged back in. So it's safe to say that 10 years from now, that yes, I will still be holding that bucket in the ring. And it would be safe to say that there will still be people asking, who's that guy holding that bucket?
You going back.
Here we go.
Here's my...
Oh, yeah. Well, maybe it's a common curse. Maybe things get bad before they get worse. I don't want to become someone who can't live up to what I already done. Don't keep it just to figure it out. Well, it rains and pours and then it runs out. I was crying on the bathroom floor. And just when I thought I could take no more, well,
and the boys with the brown skinny legs, they go on.
gay!